Good evening. This is the last in the first series of Speak for Yourself programmes, in which you, London Weekend viewers, have used our facilities to make your own television productions. Naturally, certain recurrent themes have arisen: the problems of homelessness, the care of the young, crises in education, and protests for conservation and for civil rights. This week, the shelter organisation will be putting the record straight about those proposed amendments to the Rent Act. The Alexandra Palace Action Group are here to talk about the state of play up there. And this week's main item comes from a group who say they know a thing or two about discrimination, the Campaign for Homosexual Equality.
Gay people can be found in every section of our society. What you probably don't realise is that you are probably standing next to one in this crowd. You are probably living next door to one, or underneath one, or above one. That your child is probably being taught by at least one homosexual in his school, that the doctor who is operating on you is a homosexual, and that they are everywhere. They are basically ordinary, very often boring, very natural human beings.
How to spot a possible homo. You will find that queers fall into these categories.
The middle-aged man, unmarried, who has an unnaturally strong affection for his mother.
The man who has a consuming interest in youth.
The over-clean man.
The man in the bar who drinks alone.
Anybody with a grain of sense can smell the homos amongst these men, said the psychiatrist.
When I got home, there was a ring on my knocker, which is rather unusual. This fella called, he said, I'm the gas man. Just like that, I'm the gas man. He said, I've come to convert you. So I'm going to make you natural. I thought you got a bleeding job on your hands.
When I was 20, it was the first time I came across the word homosexual in a book. And therefore, I was unable to form any meaningful emotional relationship of the kind which I longed for. I was unable to talk to anybody about what I felt because I was ashamed of it.
How long have you been like this, Mr. Squeaker? What a catastrophe.
Trying to learn the
I wish I was a pigeon, I'd just shit on your head.
We live in a society which uses sex not as a social and personal fulfillment, but he uses it as a form of social control.
The Campaign for Homosexual Equality has a membership of 4,000 women and men who never go near the law courts, never get mentioned in the press, who bear no resemblance to the collar and tie woman or to the limp-wristed queen as portrayed by the radio and television comedians.
You may have children who are homosexuals and they grow up.
Che, as we call it, provides congenial social activities through local groups, of which there are over 20 in and around London. This group organised a Sunday afternoon boat trip. The Campaign for Homosexual Equality is dedicated to improving conditions for homosexuals and bisexuals in society by tackling the law, the church, the medical profession, education, employment, and civil rights. Our London Information Centre receives visitors from all over the world.
Come in.
London members drop in for coffee and a chat, to join a group, or for counselling. We are law-abiding citizens, indistinguishable in society as couples or individuals. Yet we are discriminated against solely because of what we do in bed.
I came down and I met somebody from one of the local groups. And he said, well, why not try and come along to a group meeting and hear more about CHE. But I had a chat with him for about an hour or so. And the impressive thing for me was that I was at least asked able to talk about homosexuality, you know, as a subject which I'd never done before. It'd always been something to laugh at or something like that.
But you knew where you were, as it were, and when you came to CHU, you knew you were gay. I mean, you weren't sort of hung up about it particularly. You wanted to...
No, I certainly was hung up.
You were very
hung up. I was. From the age of about 14, I knew I'd had this feeling inside me, but the kind of image of a homosexual I had was either a dirty old man in a plastic Mac or a sort of handbag person, and I didn't think that I was one of either of those. Mm. And so I really wanted to get rid of this, and I contacted CHE to see if they could help me in that way.
Because you could almost have come to Friend as much as to CHE, you know. Did you know of the existence of
Friend? I didn't know Friend existed then, in fact, no. What do they do?
Well, basically, Friend is a counselling organisation, really set up for people who would find it very difficult to go into a group of gay people alone for the first time.
Yes.
They may be just sort of isolated. They may have had a relationship which is bust up, and they don't want to, you know, find the commercial scene very unattractive. Martin, can you answer, please?
Martin, Campaign for Homosexual Equality.
The cure for homosexuals. Two leading psychiatrists claim that LSD can cure homosexuals.
Homosexuals cured more easily in prison.
Everything conspires to tell us we're straight, we're going to be heterosexuals and go out and get married to someone of the opposite sex and have children. So how does one find out one's gay? Eddie?
Well, in my case, it's something which dawned on me when I was about 16 or 17. But in retrospect, I can see that there were signs that I was not, perhaps, as other lads of my age, and that I wasn't interested in other girls, and I wasn't interested in learning to dance and youth clubs and things like that. And in my case, it just came to me very slowly over a period of perhaps 6-9 months that I was my partner, or the sort of person I was looking for, was not a girl, but was another fellow of my own age. I was very lucky because my parents had for some time thought that perhaps I was homosexual, and I was very lucky in that they supported me during this very, very difficult time, and much of my present stability I owe to their help, support and love, which I got at that stage.
How long have you been living with Chris in a sort of pair bond situation?
Well, it's about 10 years.
About 10
now.
Years?
Yes.
Yes.
And, you know, it seems to work very well for us.
Yes.
It's very... I think we complement each other's personalities. We have a lot of interests in common, and those sort of things do obviously make for, you know, a sort of a good situation for us.
Yes. When we talk about homosexuals, we usually think, or the world at large thinks, in terms of men, because of the misunderstanding of the word homo, I suppose, which really means same, not man, in the word homosexual.
Yes.
And of course, there are lots and lots of girls who are homosexual too. Maureen, how did you first realise that you were homosexual?
Well, it was a very gradual process. I didn't wake up one morning and decide I was a homosexual or find out.
No.
It was more of a recognising of potential. I knew I wasn't capable, or the heterosexual relationship didn't appeal to me. And if I thought of myself in a relationship, it wasn't with a man, it was with a girl.
Yes.
And I had to learn to accept that over a period, it wasn't an immediate thing.
Yes. Eddie's just told us that his parents were very supportive to him. Have you found the same with your parents, or have you not told them yet?
No, I have told my parents.
Yes.
They live in Scotland, so it means that they are slightly cut off. They don't understand at all.
No.
They thought it was something that was physical. They thought I was different from other girls, which of course I'm not.
No.
They thought I dislike men, which of course I don't.
For Margaret here, your son Michael, he's gay. Did he tell you suddenly?
No, he didn't tell me. I knew.
You knew?
I knew.
How did you know?
well, I knew that he was always associating with male friends.
You'd seen what sort of friends he had, yes.
The type of friends he had.
Yes.
And I found that they were all very nice people.
Yes, yes.
And they weren't all young, you know, they were people a bit older than Michael.
Yes.
Like 2 or 3 years, give and take.
Yes.
And then he eventually paired up with his friend who he has now.
Yes, Tony, yes.
And we all live together and we find we're quite...
So, you'd seen a lot of, and met a lot of Michael's friends.
Oh, yes.
Because I find, I don't know about anybody else, but lots of parents, when they hear their kid is gay, they think, oh my God, what a lot of terrible people you must be mixing with.
No, not
you know, all terrible types. But you hadn't found that.
I haven't found that, no, but I've heard from other people, you know,
yes,
lady friends and what have you,
yes,
that they do tend to think that gay people are very strange, which
yes,
is ridiculous.
Absolutely, yes.
And they seem to think that they all go round with handbags and like a Danny LaRue
set,
you know.
Some of us do. Some of us do.
Ah, that's the female.
What parents don't know. Who on earth wants to bring up a boy who is capable only of falling in love with another boy?
That's quite interesting, I'm hearing that call, because, in fact, obviously the caller thought that we were a campaigning political organisation.
Well, yes.
And I think that's why, in fact, some people do come
we'll
to friend.
We try friend first,
yes,
because it's emphasis on counselling,
yes,
and befriending.
That's it, yeah. And I think that, you know, people may be very, you know, sort of frightened off by the sort of campaigning aspect, although, in fact, CHE fulfils both functions as, you know, a political organisation and also as a social organisation.
What sort of counselling does it do?
In friend?
Yes.
Well, it's basically, it starts with a one-to-one counselling situation, which is pretty conventional, I suppose. But we try very hard to get people out onto, you know, into a group situation where other gay people as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm.
For some people, it'll take a heck of a long time. They may be very, very withdrawn. It may be, particularly with an older person who has just suddenly come to terms with the fact that they are gay. They may find it very, very frightening. They may be worried about their job, about family. I mean, could be a married chap, you know, or
yes,
a married girl who comes to us. And so it could be very difficult for them to, you know, to eventually ease themselves out to actually meeting groups of gay people.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how we start, in a very much a one-to-one situation, like you and I sitting here.
Yes.
You know, just talking about how you feel about being gay.
200 army girls in immorality probe, holding hands in the television room.
Kissing in the ironing room.
The girls have been told that they will be on a charge if they contact the press.
Love without men. It's one way of loving.
When the aim is to spite men.
Ladies and gentlemen,
hallelujah,
you are looking at a roaring lesbian. I am one of those people who do nasty things with girl guides, according to society. I also am a dyke, a bent, a pervert.
Yeah, I've got a question. Can the homosexual be pregnant?
Thousands of women in this country who are also homosexual. Society has the impression that homosexuality is only the male scene. It is also including women.
Yolanda, we haven't heard from you yet. She has a very attractive young woman. Presumably, men treat you as a spare bird.
They do.
Yes.
I just tell them now that, you know, I'm gay and I have a girlfriend and I'm happy, and they react in all sorts of funny ways. They usually ask me to invite my girlfriend along too.
What, to make a threesome?
The blind date.
Something like that. At work it's quite an issue because I'm very open about it, and like the other day at work, some slips came around from personnel asking about next of kin, and
yes,
it had marital status, and I thought, well, what am I supposed to put? And so I put homosexual, and I put Maureen as my next of kin.
I think the thing which is very wrong is that we're caricatured. Certainly, I mean, we all vary in our personalities and in our attitudes to everything around us. But what is strange is that even we find that we don't believe we're homosexuals because we don't respond to the caricature which isn't painted of ourselves.
Well, I'm a homosexual and I don't think that I'm like it. What do you mean by that?
No, what I mean is when we're finding out about ourselves.
Oh, when we're finding out. Oh, yes.
Because the image we have of a homosexual, a queer, a fairy, is not at all what we see ourselves.
We see ourselves. No.
And this is part of the confusion of society in general.
Yes.
That they can't accept that homosexuals are people.
Yes.
And this is the difference.
Yes.
So do you find that we have trouble accepting ourselves as people because of this? You know, like growing up, I had the idea of the stereotype butch dyke.
Yes.
And I love motorbikes.
Don't we all?
But all the other things that went with it, I didn't really feel attracted to. And so I was very confused. I thought, well, I don't like this, and yet I...
You're not like that.
I found like preferring women's company. Like if I had a choice between a date with a boyfriend and a girlfriend, I'd put off the date with a boyfriend to go with a girlfriend.
Yes.
And I found this difficult to understand. I thought, well, what is it? And you keep expecting to get over it, and as the years go by and you get to 25 and you haven't gotten over it.
Certainly at schools, all the education you have, well, it wasn't very much when I was at school, but certainly all the sexual education is aimed at heterosexual pairing.
Yes, it's a bland assumption.
And any homosexual, anything about homosexuality is usually treated as dirty or perverse, which for a child that has homosexual feelings, it can be disastrous.
Oh, absolutely.
I feel very strongly that, you know, the sex education should at least indicate that homosexuality is quite common and that it isn't a dirty, perverted practice at all.
I don't know what it is that makes me love you so. I only know I never want to let you go. Cause you started something that you see. But ever since we met, you had a hold on me. It happens to be true.
They slink from the shadows. The once golden picture of Hampstead Heath is tarnished indeed. Here is a section of public park that is unsafe for ordinary people. Here is a group of sick men who openly affront the passer-by.
I find that lots of people equate homosexuality with promiscuity. Yet here we've got two couples, two girls, two boys, both pairs of whom have settled down in what might appear to be a marriage situation. Do you regard yourself as married?
Well, do I object most strongly to the use of the term marriage, as it rather indicates that we're aping heterosexual life. And this is something which I certainly do not do. Homosexuals have their own lifestyle, and marriage as such is not part of it.
I mean, practically, the setup isn't the same as the heterosexual relationship. Practically, you have two girls living together. The housework is split completely down the middle, which is quite unusual.
I think that there is a great deal of promiscuity, but I think there's a great deal of promiscuity among most young people experimenting. I think the pressures on homosexuals are such that it's difficult for them to live together.
Yes.
And therefore they tend to find it more difficult to settle down as pairs. And bachelors of any sex do look around a great deal more.
Relationships that do stay together are usually very strong because you haven't got so many influences trying to keep you together. Like, yeah. if we have a fight or something, it's just between us to make it up.
Yes.
We can't go and get counseled by anyone, or people at work don't sympathise or anything like that.
There's a lot of gay women who are very interested in allowing gay female couples to adopt children, or even to have AID, to have their own children without a man. How do you feel about that?
It's not really an issue with us.
I think gay women should be allowed to adopt children.
Yes.
Many of them make very good mothers. I mean, the fact that they are lesbian doesn't mean that they are any different from other women.
We are human beings, you know. Right. This is the point. We're not child molesters, or we're not all chasing kids. We would be as good or as bad parents as the average heterosexual is. There's no reason to think we should be otherwise.
We're ready, say scouts. Scouts are leaving nothing to chance. As soon as their tents go up on Hampstead Heath, notorious haunt of homosexuals, the army will move in.
I remember for myself, I had a specific religious problem. The organisation I belong to forbade practicing homosexuality. Do you have people to help with that kind of thing?
Yes, we have, in fact, the broad spectrum of religious opinion. We have got Roman Catholic priests, CV, Methodists, who we use as advisors in this particular situation. Because I think it's no good, somebody who is, say, a non-Roman Catholic trying to tell somebody who is a Roman Catholic that it's not a sin. They've just, they can't cope with that. But if they can talk to a Roman Catholic about it, and a priest at that, who is sympathetic and, does not consider it sinful to be homosexual, it's much easier for them, I think.
What about people under 21? The obvious legal problems.
Well, yes, there is a legal hang-up as to whether, in fact, what the position of counselling service is for under 21s. Mm-hmm. But bearing in mind that we get referrals at FREN from the probation service, from social services, for a large percentage of the time, they do not know what to do with a gay client who presents themselves in a probation office or a social services department. Yeah. And they certainly don't know what gay organisations to send them to. But it is a problem because the law at the moment, as you know, with regard to under 21s for males, makes it, homosexual acts illegal.
Yes.
But we purely are counselling them and helping them to come to terms with it.
Yes, that's the main problem I found, to actually come to terms and realising myself that it wasn't wrong, that I was doing it wrong. And it was maybe 6 months or so before I actually could tell my parents. I could actually stop lying to them about where I had been and what I'd been doing for the weekend. Mm. I found that quite a problem.
You've met my mother, haven't you?
I have, yes. I met her last Sunday, in fact, yes.
I'm just going to ask her if we could have a cup of coffee. Mum?
Yeah?
Is it possible to have a cup of coffee?
Yes.
Oh, great, thanks. It's a great, I think it is for a lot of people, a great problem with parents, but, and it was for you, was it?
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mum.
David?
Thanks a lot.
People always talk about phases. Oh, it's a homosexual phase you're going through. But, I never went through a heterosexual phase.
I don't think I did either.
No. It's funny, they always, if you talk about people passing through phases, it's always the homosexual phase. Not the heterosexual.
I did go through a heterosexual phase. Yes. Very short.
Well, in the same way that people say it's homosexual,
Day after day, I must face a world of strangers where I don't belong, and that it's strong. It's nice to know that there's someone I can turn to who will always care. You're always there
when there's no getting over that rainbow, when my smallest of dreams won't come true. I can't take all the madness the world has to give, but I won't last a day without you.
many times when the city seems to be without a friendly face. A lonely place. It's nice to know that you'll be there if I need you, and you'll always smile. It's all worthwhile when there's no getting over that rainbow. When my smallest of dreams won't come true, I can't take all the madness the world has to give. But I won't last a day without you. Touch me and I end up singing. Troubles seem to up and disappear. You touch me with the love you're bringing.
Those of you who want to contact the campaign or its counselling service will find telephone lines open from now at the following offices. Che's address is Basement, 22 Great Windmill Street, London, W1V7PH, and the telephone 01437 7363. And Friend, 47 Church Street, Lisson Grove, London NW8, telephone 01402 6750. Lines at both addresses are open all night. And in part two, we'll be hearing from an international celebrity whose association with Che has led to an unhappy experience. Also, Alexandra Palace, and from Shelter, Landlords and Tenants. So join us again in part two.
I just want to be beside you everywhere. As long as we're together, honey, I don't care. Cause you started something, and can't you see?
In part one, you saw members of the Campaign for Homosexual Equality talking about their own experiences of petty discriminations and irritations. Che's experience in Tunbridge Wells recently has been even more disappointing. Here in the studio are Peter Caton, the concert pianist, and Ross Burgess, Che organiser for Tunbridge Wells. Well, Ross, you tried to organise a concert. Can you tell me what happened?
Yes. Well, I'm speaking really now for the three CHE groups in Tunbridge Wells. And we decided to organise a concert in aid of CHE locally. And we were very pleased when we got Peter Caton, internationally distinguished pianist, to agree to come and give a recital for us. So far, so good. The next thing was booking a hall to have it. We tried various halls in Kent, but the only one which seemed suitable and was free at the particular time we wanted to have the concert was the Assembly Hall in Tunbridge Wells. So we made a telephone call, at least one of my colleagues in the Medway groups made a telephone call to the people in charge of the Assembly Hall.
Who's that?
It's actually owned by the District Council, and it's the amenities officer who's in charge of it, apparently.
The District Council of Tunbridge Wells?
District Council of Tunbridge Wells, yes. Anyway, we made the telephone call, not at that stage saying it was CHE, but just in general terms asking if we could have the Assembly Hall for a concert on the particular date. All seemed to be okay, and they agreed that we could do that. Then my colleague wrote confirming the booking to Tunbridge Wells Council and had a reply from the amenities officer there saying that in view of the nature of the organisation that was holding the or it was sponsoring the concert, they weren't able to let the booking go forward. They felt that this was not the sort of organisation which they should be promoting in the Assembly Hall.
And your colleague had given details about Che, I understand, written on Che notepaper, any attempt to hide.
No, he'd made no attempt to hide what it was all about. He'd written on CHE headed notepaper and enclosed, I think, a leaflet about CHE and some press cuttings, I think about our conference, which was held at Malvern earlier this year. Malvern, as you can imagine, is a similar sort of town to Tunbridge Wells, and the response from the local district council there was really quite good. They said it was one of the best conferences they'd had there.
What happened to Tunbridge Wells anyway? You got a refusal.
At this stage it's rather in limbo. Although we have fortunately been able to, the immunities officer and the chief executive of the council have kindly agreed to meet us and discuss the matter. So we're hoping that at this stage the thing may possibly go forward.
When is the when would the concert have been?
It would have been on the 13th of September.
Yes. Well, we actually tried to reach the local authority and speak to them, but they didn't want to comment before that meeting.
I see.
Could I ask you, Peter Caton, how did you feel when you got the news that the engagement was cancelled?
Well, I was absolutely amazed. I was furious. Because, you see, the whole point was that this was banned, shall we say, without any consultation with me whatsoever.
Have you, in fact, appeared in a number of occasions for charitable organisations giving our services free like this?
Oh, certainly.
You get other requests?
Well, yes, I mean, one gets requests all the time, but you see, you have to select the ones that you are prepared to support.
So you knew all about CHED, did you? Or you talked with your agents about this?
Yes, I did.
It seems really as if it's casting aspersions on your judgment as an artist.
Well, it does seem rather like that, I must admit. I think when one really sort of looks into every cause that one wants to support and is prepared to give a recital or a concert or what have you in aid of that cause, then it is not for the local amenities officer to ban it without some kind of consultation with the person who's going to do it.
Have you had any experience like this before in any organisation being refused?
Yes. Simply never. I have in fact given two recitals for CHE before. One was in fact for the conference, and the other one was for their music group, which was an ordinary paid engagement, and that was in London.
Mm. Well, I wish you very good luck with your meeting, and I hope the affair resolves itself. You can still get your concert. In the past couple of weeks, we've heard from two people who've been very concerned with landlords' rights. Mr. Duff spoke about the plight of the individual landlord in the light of the new bill planned to protect furnished as well as unfurnished tenants. And last week, Mr. Charles Parker of the Nationwide Housing Concern, which undertakes to provide advice to protect both landlords and tenants, expanded on Mr. Duff's views. Well, tonight we hear from Mr. Patrick Benson of Shelter, who wants to clarify the situation in terms of the present housing problem. Patrick, could you start perhaps by explaining the present freeze on rents?
Yes.
Can we go on from there?
Certainly, Peter. Basically, I really would like to clarify the situation regarding what this bill actually seeks to do, and remember that it isn't actually an Act of Parliament yet.
Yes.
The rent freeze is something really entirely separate, and that is an economic measure, and it was a freeze on both business rents and residential rents, simply to allow a cooling off period. The government have said that that freeze will come off at the end of this year, and we have every reason to think that's just what's going to happen.
It doesn't change any rights of tenants.
It doesn't affect the rights of tenants whatsoever.
So could we? Yes, I see.
Yes, and it does actually mean that landlords will be able to charge fair rents from the 1st of January, probably next year,
yes,
and actually perhaps recoup some of the money that they haven't been getting in the past year or so.
Yes, fair in quotes, perhaps. But
right, sure. Yeah. The question with the rent bill is something entirely different. Mm. All the rent bill seeks to do is to give the same very basic rights to furnished tenants as unfurnished tenants have at the moment, with one or two notable exceptions. And those exceptions are where the tenant is living in the house in which the landlord is living. In other words, we're talking really about the small landlord there, the owner-occupier who decides to let some portion of his own house, perhaps to offset the mortgage, or maybe just as a social gesture to make sure that the accommodation is fully used. Those persons will not be protected by the provisions of the new bill, nor will students, people undertaking a course of study. And I think it's very, very important to make that distinction. But the bill in no way protects the bad tenant, as the 1968 Rent Act doesn't protect the bad unfurnished tenant.
Well, Mr. Duff and Mr. Parker were talking of theft in strong language, as if, when we pressed them, every single landlord risked not getting their property back. But the exception certainly seems to suggest that the person who lives in their own house and lets some of it is safe, then.
It's extremely foolish to use emotional language to talk about this kind of legislation. All it seeks to do is to give some kind of equity to landlord and tenant. Obviously, the scales are very heavily weighted in favour of the landlord because of the scarcity of accommodation. We've accepted as a society that consumers of goods and services in other quarters have some sort of protection. And all this bill seeks to do is to give protection to good tenants. It in no way assists bad tenants. under the bill, people who commit tenancy offences, that is, not paying their rent, damaging the property, damaging the furniture, or causing a nuisance either to other tenants or to the landlord, can be evicted by due process of law, and that's through the county court. And the previous speakers have spoken about a lengthy period of time being involved. That's absolute nonsense. The rent tribunals and the county courts are very human establishments, very human bodies, and understand the problems that landlords have with bad tenants. And, you know, we're not saying there's no such thing. There certainly are bad tenants, and they can be very easily evicted by process of law.
So the bill, if it becomes law, won't stop landlords letting?
No.
In any way?
I think it's been a very unfortunate thing has happened with the introduction of this bill. There hasn't been sufficient publicity about what the provisions of the bill actually are. There's been a lot of scare tactics by people like the speakers on the previous programmes. And because of that, there has been a lot of reaction by landlords who have actually issued notices to quit, sought to get possession of their properties where they had no need to do so, where they had ordinary good tenants that they could have kept on. The important thing now is that this bill actually goes through as quickly as possible, so that those people where the process has already been started are actually safeguarded.
Mm. Of course, Shelter is not a political organisation, I understand, is it? But in fact, the political state of affairs at the moment is that the bill is having difficulty in getting through Parliament, isn't it?
Shelter is not a party political organisation, but obviously a lot of our work is about political solutions with a small p, because that's what's needed for the housing problem. The question here is one of insufficient parliamentary time, and I think everybody's aware of what the parliamentary situation is at the moment, but really the government not giving sufficient priority to the bill, and the Tory opposition being quite obstructive about the bill, tabling nonsensical amendments in the committee stage and really slowing down the due process of parliamentary procedure.
Can you say briefly in a word how you would act, as I asked the previous people on the other programmes, as a housing minister? I mean, would you wouldn't obviously repeal the Rent Act, you'd see this bill through as law. How does it shape up in the general picture of housing at the moment, for instance the housing bill and so on?
We have to consider both short and long term measures. One of the crucial short term measures is protection for furnished tenants. Mm. The long term measures, and some of those are contained in the housing bill, are that local authorities must be much more able to act in the purchase of empty properties and properties coming on the market, particularly in the urban areas. But the two bills must be seen as and worked together, because obviously there will be some shrinkage of the private rented sector with the introduction of this bill. The local authorities must be able to take that up. The housing problem fundamentally, or the solution to it rather, is a question of bringing together the resources. And those resources are the money, the cash, and of course we're talking about large sums of money, and the building and construction industry. Welding those two together, making them work in order to solve the country's housing problem.
Patrick Benson, thanks very much for coming on.
Thank you.
Also on last week's programme, Mr. Derek Lovejoy pleaded for better planned London parks, and we received plenty of correspondence about this, including one letter which pointed out that at Stuttgart, one of the European parks praised by Mr. Lovejoy, it was illegal to walk or sit on the grass, which rather limits its charm. That Victorian edifice in North London's Muswell Hill, Alexandra Palace, has been much in the news lately because of a threat to its very existence. Last week, we learnt that the Alexandra Park and Palace Advisory Board had recommended to the GLC that the building should survive, but there was uncertainty whether it would continue to be used as a leisure palace for the people, the purpose for which it was originally intended. Clive Wolfe of the APAG, the Alexandra Palace Action Group, is here tonight to air his views. And Clive, I believe that since the meeting of the advisory board, which was acclaimed in the press as a reprieve for the palace, there's been a meeting of the Arts and Recreation Committee of the GLC, which has taken really a step back. Could you explain about that?
Yes, they've not so much taken a step back as failed to take a step forward. All they've done is reverted to the position as it is at the moment and has been for the last 8 years since the GLC took over. Can I point out that since 1936, in fact, the palace has not been used as a leisure place for the people, not entirely anyway, since the BBC moved in. There's nothing against the BBC, of course. They saved the financial bacon of the place in 1936 by hiring it out. But since then, they've occupied about a third of the building, and the whole of it is not available for public recreation. Other people are using other parts of the building and so on. But what the Arts and Recreation Committee did last Wednesday was, in fact, to hold up things a little bit, I hope only a little bit, by calling for complete rundown, financial options and so on what happens if the palace is retained, and more alarmingly, what happens if it's pulled down. which is a reversion to the position of the previous 8 years, when nobody knew whether the place was going to stay up or not.
For the previous 8 years since the GLC has become the trustee.
That's right. What
is the responsibility of the trustee?
Well, in the 1900 Act of Parliament, appointed trustees, when the commercial management had failed before that, to maintain and improve the building for the recreation of the, and resort of the people. And yet, in the last 8 years, I'm sorry to harp on it, but I'm not just getting at the GLC, they probably mean very well, and a lot of them do take exactly the point of view that we do, but the fact is that in 8 years, they haven't yet made a definite decision even to retain the building they were entrusted to improve,
now
not even to knock down.
That is a full GLC.
No,
the
that wasn't
advisory
the GLC.
Board
hasn't
has
got
recommended
that,
its return.
Hasn't got to the GLC yet. Yes, the advisory board, which was set up last year to look at the future of the palace, last week recommended that the place be retained. They hadn't gone into the financial options or anything like that, so they didn't take the decision on financial grounds. Now, people are calling for full rundowns on what happens if it is retained and so on.
In fact, many Londoners will know it as a place where you can have fun. I mean, I remember cricket, indoor cricket nets, Alf Gover's school and all the rest of it. There have been fairs and ad hoc happenings there. But you're asking for something very much more.
Yes,
we're asking. What, in fact, would you want to see happening there?
Well, we'd like to see the whole place used for its original intention, as a place of recreation and resort for the people
have
of London.
Particular plans?
Well, not particularly, no. There are so many options open that it would be invidious to single out one at the moment. I mean, the place could become a living Victoriana centre. It could have 40 different activities going on there at the same time, or it could concentrate on music or drama or both and so on, and they even have a lot of sport in it. There are masses of options open. All it needs is a bit of imagination and drive, and above all, speed, because all that's happening at the moment is that time is being wasted, a lot of public money is being wasted, a very great deal, and there's no sign that it's going to stop happening.
The waste of public money at the moment is due to what? Deterioration of the building?
Partly
sort of
because of that, and obviously it's going to cost more every time. Now, take the organ, for example, which was sold by the GLC for £500 in 1971 rather than restore it. Now, at the time they sold it, they didn't get rid of it at all because the casing is still there. But at the time they sold it, it would have cost perhaps £40,000, £50,000 to restore. Now it would cost £150,000, and a lot of people are determined that this world masterpiece is not going to be passed over.
But it's too late now, it's sold.
No, it's not too late. The chap who bought it for £500 is merely holding it in trust for the public until he's asked to restore it, because he is the grandson of the original builder.
I see. In fact, then, what would you advise people to do who would, like you, would want more things to happen at Alexandra Palace and something to happen quickly?
Well, it's not possible in this space of time, obviously, to go into details, but if they care to contact us, we'd be very glad to tell them what to do or suggest what they might do. And one very good example, one very good opportunity for contacting us, apart from through the post, which I hope they'll do, is to come to our next open meeting.
Date and place?
It's at 8 o'clock on Wednesday the 23rd of October, up at the Palace, in the Palace Suite, and we're going to precede it by a two-hour tour of the building, upstairs and downstairs. It's a fascinating place. 6 o'clock for those who want the tour, but please let us know beforehand that they're coming, because we can only cater for a certain number. And we're also going to bring out our own quarterly magazine about the palace to try and get a little bit of action and promote what is on there at the moment. That'll come out about August the 10th, called The Palace Guard.
Great. Well, Clive, let's end by looking at the address to which people should write for details of the Palace Guard and of the meeting in October. That's the Alexandra Palace Action Group, 20 Lansdowne Road, Muswell Hill, London, North 10. Well, this is not pat on the back time, but to end with, we have tried to evaluate the results of this first series by combing through your mail and telephone calls, and also by sending a questionnaire to all those who appeared on Speak for Yourself. Has anything been changed by the programmes? That's really the test. Well, remember the residential boat owners. Their big worry has been the complete absence of any security of tenure, less even than squatters' rights, for their boats, which are also their homes.
What is wanted is a change in the law to give houseboats the same status as homes on land. At present, they're regarded merely as chattels, which means the law can give them no protection from harassment or summary eviction. The Residential Boat Owners Association has been campaigning for a more enlightened attitude. Some water authorities do seem to understand some of the problems and the potential, and we've had some support from individual councillors and MPs. But unfortunately, too few councils seem to really understand the situation, and two governments have successively point-blank refused to do anything to help the situation at all. The present government is particularly bad in that it's broken promises made to us during the election campaign and has in fact introduced sanctions that make it more expensive and therefore more difficult to buy a houseboat.
Since that programme, the Liberal peer Lord Avebury has agreed to help houseboat owners in their long fight for legal protection by promoting a bill in the House of Lords. And we know of some other details. For example, East, the community group in Newham, were coming on tonight about the loss of their premises and an uncertain future, but this week they were given a new home. And Mrs. Gittis, you remember, was concerned about lonely people in London. Well, she's managed to form a number of groups who meet on Sundays to combat loneliness in London. Then there's the Mayville Estate in Islington. They're getting their community club. The electricity transformer building is being converted after all. Some groups received support and extra helpers. Others have had abuse, even harassment and threats. Mrs. Jean Rennie, who campaigned against library charges for authors, was surprised to receive almost no comment at all. A comment maybe on our view of the writer in society. Adam Joseph's efforts to establish a Cockney Museum have got somewhere, and currently you can see it at Selfridges in Oxford Street. As for the group protesting about forced feeding in prisons, they will now not need to make a reappearance since the Home Secretary recently ordered an end to this practice. The National Union of School Students, who've been much in the news since the programme, report to us that for the first time, parents and teachers are actively supporting the objectives. After Six is the organisation concerned with the problem of finding accommodation for childless couples and single people.
The problem of single homeless people is usually seen as a psychiatric problem. For most councils, the term single homeless person means a tramp, or a dosser, or a vagrant. The problem of single homeless people is seen as one of deviance rather than simple need. It's said that they don't just need a house, they need to be rehabilitated. Now, this isn't true. Most of the single people in London today, without places of their own, are working and earning a regular wage. They have nothing in common except their homelessness. Their problem doesn't stem from any personal inadequacy. It's part of the general housing problem that exists in London.
For After Six, the results of producing a programme were to cause them to almost crack under the strain of still more people seeking help. There's no evidence to show that views have been seriously altered, but problems have been aired that would have otherwise not been heard. And those who spoke for themselves agreed in their answer to our questionnaire that they did say what they wanted to say in their own way. Most found it more work than they'd bargained for, often a problem in fitting it into their own work. Well, viewers responded from one extreme to the other. After all, they numbered each week between 3 and 5 times or more the capacity of Wembley Stadium. So it's you we must thank for your participation and your comments. To tie up one loose end, the theme music, which a number of you have asked about, is called Bummin' Along, and it's published by Essex Music, but unfortunately the recording is not available to the public. We expect to have another series of Speak for Yourself next season. Advertisements will appear closer to the date for applicants to appear on the programme. If you want to put your case on record ahead of time, do write in to the address we've been giving you each week. It's Speak for Yourself, London Weekend Television, Kent House, Upper Ground, London SE1 9LT. So it's goodbye from me, Peter Lewis, and from all of us in the production team.